understand from John that our internet ministry continues to grow, that we're, since our biggest outreach aside from the U.S. is in Russia. And people coming and listening to the whole sessions, and somebody's plugged in into the Word of God. So, hello. I'm personally studying the book of Colossians, and I'm going to share with you some ideas from that book. If you'll look with me and turn in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 1. As always, there's some kind of propaganda movement. The devil is a liar, and one of the ways that he lies is he's a propagandist. You see it going on in our nation through our news media even today, where things are misrepresented as a matter of policy, as a matter of daily course. The goal is to misrepresent reality. This was happening in the book of Colossians, that people were propagandizing the person of Jesus Christ. Paul comes along and writes this book to establish the person of Christ and who he was. It's always been attacks. The devil hates the Lord Jesus Christ. Some kind of competition between the two of them throughout eternity. And his goal is always to diminish him and to promote himself and diminish Jesus Christ. He's all but distracted the church away from Jesus Christ into all kinds of other activities and everything just to distract us away from developing a relationship that's real. Christ is a real person. He wants to have a real relationship that you can experience within your soul through the Holy Spirit. That is the goal of the Christian life, is to have a personal inner experience that fills your soul, gives you hope about your future, and enables you to have the strength to reach out and nurture and give to others. This year, this reaching out to people to bring them here or to the internet is about helping them with that, with information and things that they need for their life, so that they can find contentment and peace. Who doesn't want that? But we're out chasing it all kinds of ways, and the propaganda has misdirected even the church. Many wouldn't come to this church, even though this is going to be very practical for you today. This is going to be a way for you to look at your life and go, wow, God is good. That's the message. But we don't have all of the big budget music and the big budget building and the big budget everything. And so others would say, well, that's not much of a church. Let me tell you, the substance is what you're after, not the trappings. So let's look at if you've got your sheets, the book of Colossians, the purpose. Paul wanted to establish a true Christology. There was a great deal of misinformation. The Gnostics, what was the beginning of the Gnostics, were in this church trying to deceive people. He also wrote it to refute these false teachers. They were teaching a mix of Greek and Jewish ascetic mysticism. They were saying things like, listen, see if you've heard this today, show you things haven't really changed. That being spiritual is about don't touch, don't taste, don't handle. What it is that you touch or taste or drink or eat or not. Those who don't touch or taste or handle, of course, are the spiritual ones. You ever heard that? Nothing changes. All still the same. They were teaching this ascetic life where everything was about not failing. What I hate the most about the churches that teach people that being spiritual is about not failing, not sinning. They think that failure is about sinning, and if you can not sin. Listen, God wants you moving toward Him at light speed, wide open, looking for a relationship. He doesn't want you to sin, but sin is not the issue. It's been paid for. When you sin, you get back up and move on. But this teaching was, be careful. Be careful. God will get you. I hear it all the time. Be careful what you do or don't do. God will get you. Listen, if God wanted to get you, how hard would you be to get? I mean, most of us are too old to move very fast. I mean, I can't even run anymore. God is not out to get you. Your future is not about stepping in the wrong place or doing the wrong thing and God being out to get you. That is not the plan of God. The plan of God is positive, hopeful. He has a future for you that if you really saw it and understood it, you would jump for joy. So let's learn about it and so we can jump for joy. Anybody here want to jump for joy? There you go. I can't jump very high, but I can jump. Thirdly, he wanted to develop an accurate description of the Christian life in contrast to this false way of thinking. One of the things that you notice about the book of Colossians is that from chapter 2 to chapter 4, there are 22 imperatives. That's a lot. In really, 2, 3, 4, in three chapters, there's 22 commands. When you find all these commands bunched up together, you see Paul giving you exhortation about how to live the Christian life. He's commanding, all right, do this, don't do that. Here's how you do it, here's how you don't do it. He's instructing us. Chapter 1, the first two verses, I'll basically gloss over for the moment, but this is a standard introduction. He's an apostle by the will of God. And Timothy, I want you to notice that Paul emphasizes Timothy. The reason is Timothy is going to end up inheriting this leadership role once Paul's gone. And Paul is beginning to promote him in the eyes of these people. He's a young guy. He would easily be looked over. He'd easily be run over when he goes to these other churches. And Paul is putting his name out there saying, look, here's a guy you need to think of as a leader. So he's preparing the people for that. In verses 3 through 8, we're going to look. He says, Paul, let's read what we're doing here. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers in Christ who are at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. Pretty standard introduction. And then he says, we give thanks to God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have for all the saints, because of the hope that is being laid up for you in heaven, of which you have previously heard in the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you just as in all the world. It is constantly bearing fruit and increasing, even as it has been doing in you, or among you also since the day you heard of it and understood the grace of God in truth. Just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow bondservant, who is a faithful servant of Christ on our behalf. And he has also informed us of your love in the Spirit. Now I want to talk today about hope, because this is a big, big part of this passage. He says, we're thankful because we've heard of your faith and your love. If you'll look at verse 4, since we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and your love for other believers. And he says, because of, where is their faith in Christ Jesus has eventuated in love for other believers, and the missing link between those two, salvation and growth, and love for others is hope. He says in verse 5, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Now, if you'll look again at your sheet, in verse 5, you've got di plus the accusative feminine singular of elpis, the word hope. Dia plus the accusative means because of the hope. Now we're going to look at that word hope, but that word literally means expectation. It's not our hope. The word hope in English means I hope so. It's a wish. I wish this could happen. The word elpis in the Greek doesn't mean I wish. It means I expect. I anticipate. I am confident that something's going to happen. What we have here in this word hope, see, faith is a character of the soul and love is a characteristic of the soul, but the hope here, which is a characteristic of the soul, is not the hope of the soul, it's what is hoped for. It's the object of hope. What is it that you're hoping for? That's the question today. What is it you're hoping for? What is it you're expecting your life to be? Bring you contentment. What's got to happen in your life for you to be content and happy? That's the question. Now, these believers had heard and believed the gospel, bringing them to eternal salvation. The gospel is this. If you've never heard this, if you're a visitor here, when Jesus Christ hung on the cross, every sin of the human race, past, present, and future, every last one of them was put on him, and he was punished for all those sins in our place. When he had finished paying for all the sins, he said, "It is finished." And he physically died. He spiritually died by paying for the sins of the world. Then he physically died and went to the heart of the earth. 3 days later, he came back to life. He was resurrected and defeated death. He defeated sin on the cross and death in his resurrection, and he did that for you, for you. And he says, if you'll simply believe between you and me that I did that for you and that's your only ticket to heaven, that is the only ticket there is, folks. If you think doing good works is gonna count with God, it's not going to count anything. It's the work of Jesus Christ that counts. You put your faith in that, it gives you eternal life. They had done that. It had brought them into this born-again state. And they had then learned the promises of the eternal blessings of life with God. They had also believed in this eternal hope in heaven. Because they were confident and expected that when they died, they would be transferred to eternal bliss. This gave them inner security. Listen, here's the power of hope. Hope is about what you see coming. What you see coming. I mean, there's a lot of people in the business world that are very hopeful, confident about this year with this new administration and this new mindset about business, about the economy. You're going to see the economy rev up because it's based on confidence. Everything's based on the willingness to spend money revs the economy up. That's because as people look forward, they are confident and they expect the business world to increase. They expect it. That's our word. It's to expect. Now, what it is you're expecting your life to be when it ends or even along the way is what is determining your general disposition and feeling and experience you have inside. If you're expecting everything to go south, then I don't think you're a very happy person. Would you agree with that? I mean, if everything's going to go bad and all you can see is the worst, now that might explain why you got that frown. Why you're so prickly and difficult to get along with. And you know you are. I mean, your mate has tried to tell you 100 times, but you know, they're trying to be nice. But, you know, finally they get tired of it and they go, "You're hard to live with." Well, why are you hard to live with? Because you have your hope, your expectation is attached to loss, to losing, to nothing good. That's not the Christian life. The Christian life is attaching your hope to all the good stuff that God's going to do. So, once that's in your soul and gives you security, then your inner peace from security, from hoping in God, expecting good things, strengthens you to give to others. That's how this works. You see, the Christian command to love other people is not for you to give to people out of a dry soul, out of an empty soul. Most people I've known that call themselves Christians have tried to give out of an empty soul. Going through the motions. The person who's growing in the Lord and moving closer and experiencing God as a reality in their own soul is vibrant. Your juices are flowing. Your spiritual juices are flowing. You're learning. You're growing. You're asking questions. You're getting answers. You're learning how to deal with life. You're getting victory over the difficulties of your life. You want to share that with other people. So you're reaching out to others constantly, consistently. I had a fun time yesterday. We went to Walmart, which we do about 3 or 4 times every day. I looked through the bank account the other day, and it was like, Walmart, 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 Walmart. You know, and when there's like a whole page of Walmarts on one day, you're like, well, no wonder we got no money. But when we go through the line, I always ask the cashier if they've heard of Jesus. You ever heard of Jesus? And of course they've heard of Jesus. I know that. And I started talking to this lady. I said, have you heard of Jesus? And she said, we've had this discussion before. I realized I had made my rounds. You know it's a good, you know that you know that you've been reaching out when, now she remembered me, but I didn't remember her. But anyway, listen, I'm very hopeful about where I'm headed. I'm very hopeful. I'm very confident about where I'm headed. I want to share that. That's ministry. That's how ministry works. Ministry is not something you have to sit back in a room and plan together and get all, I mean, you're planning and all that's good. And then you recruit people to fill no. People get full of God. And they get inspired to share what God's sharing with them. And ministry begins to happen. It evolves. Gifts start to work. People team up. Things happen. That's what needs to happen here. We need to be open to the whole idea of letting God work in you, make you hopeful about your life, confident about where you're headed, about what God's going to do in your life. And see, the only way to do that is to get disengaged from material things, the earthly stuff. You got to get in. This life is not about the earthly stuff. If your hope is in all of that stuff and how much money you're going to make, what you're going to drive and where you're going to live and all that, then you're going to, maybe you'll do well. But look, it's going to be an empty thing for you. No matter how well you do, it's going to be empty. And look, you're going to build some great thing, and you and your partner are going to build some great home, this and that. Then somebody's going to get sick and die, and you're going to be by yourself again, and you're going to go, wow. Wow. Sure wasn't about all this stuff. Let me tell you, when you come to the end of your life, you're not going to be concerned about your stuff. You're not going to say, hey, I just want to go see my truck one more time. I just want to go get that new truck smell one more time. You're going to want to see your loved ones, the ones you love and care about, the ones that love you, the ones that love you. So, having your heart fixed on the right things, therefore your faith, hope, and love fixed on the right things, is going to enable you to have inner peace and strength to give to others. That's ministry. And listen, it doesn't work any other way. No, it doesn't work any other way. You can't command this stuff. You can't command people to be interested in God or in His Word. You can't make people or command them or order them or browbeat them. You can't do it. They have to come to that between them and God, and that's when they become hungry. Everything turns on, and now they're hungry. They can't get enough. Now, look, 1 Peter 2:2 says, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the Word. And that word desire is a command. It's a present active imperative, and it means you are responsible to keep yourself in a mindset, in a mode of hunger with God. Nobody else can do it for you. You have to do it for yourself, and you have to tell yourself, because it's easy to get distracted, even doing good stuff. If you'll notice, faith, hope, and love are three things that Paul puts together consistently. These natural capacities of the soul, like faith, listen, the ability to believe, the ability to be confident, the ability to hope, even the ability to choose fear, anger, hatred, all of these things must have an object. I need you to listen to this. This is real important. None of these characteristics of the soul, faith, hope, love, anger, fear, jealousy, bitterness, none of these things operate without an object. If you're fearful in your life, it means you're fearful about something. If you hate something, then you must hate something. You don't just fear. You don't just hate. You know, you watch TV and people talk about they want to have a spiritual moment. And they say, well, I think it's important to have faith. I always laugh when I hear that stuff on the TV. And I'm always saying, faith in what? Faith means simply to believe. Believe what? What do you believe? Hope means to be confident about your future. Confident about what? What you attach it to is a choice that you make. And we too often attach our faith and hope to the negative side of life. We spend our life in fear. Worried, 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 worried. About the test that we got to take or the what's going to happen. Say you disobeyed your parents. Now you got to face the music. And you're all fearful, fearful, fearful. Angry, angry, angry. And you're coming up with story after story after story. That's so fun to watch. I enjoy watching that happen with my kids. They're sitting in the back, and I just said all that for their benefit. But faith, hope, and love are Paul's view of the human soul. And you can look at these passages, 1 Corinthians 13:13. He says, now remains faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. And they're a system that works together. And here's the idea. Whatever you believe is what you expect. And whatever you expect, you develop relationship strategies to accomplish. If you believe that having money is going to bring you happiness, then you're going to build a mindset, an image in your mind of yourself with money. And then you're going to develop a relationship skills to be able to accomplish that in your life. It works, it's just a system. Now, let's talk about what is hope, the doctrine of hope. The word elpizo, the verb, and elpis, the noun, means to expect, to anticipate. It means to have confident expectation, to attach confidence to a future event or situation. The word hope in the Bible means to be confident about your future, whatever it is going to be. Now, one of the things that I know about all of our future is that unless the rapture occurs, we're all going to die. Did you know that? I'm confident about that. Now, you say, well, that's a downer. No, it's not. Why is that a downer? Why is that a downer? I'm ready. Let's go. I mean, I think the entertainment in heaven is going to be better than it is here. There are going to be more channels. They're going to be all relevant. Cheaper too. Absolutely cheaper. Absolutely. Now, faith and hope are two sides of the same coin. You got to understand this. Faith is says, I believe X. Hope or expectation means because I believe X, I expect X to happen. If I believe that having money or having love, romantic love, or security is the key to happiness, then I set up in my mind this expectation that somehow God is going to make that happen. He's going to make that happen. And then I'm going to develop skills to cooperate with God, to work with God, to make all that work in my life. I'm going to find a way to get secure. Problem is that you're already secure because He's already promised to meet all of your needs. If you would ever. You know, listen, the best thing, Larry Crabb wrote a book called Shattered Dreams. Wow, what a book. We all think our first dream in life, which is all material and earthly and worldly and about love and success and prosperity, is all about, that's where happiness is. And it's not until God allows that whole dream to crash and burn and you emerge from the ashes that you realize that the dream is Him. Life with Him. It's not about any of this stuff. Now we know that, but we just can't get away from all that stuff. You have to grow out of it. And faith says when your faith is in God as your source, then you begin to expect your life to be about God. For God to do things in your life to bring you closer. He says, if you'll draw near to me, He'll do what? He'll draw near to you. So, expectation says, if I draw near to God, I believe that. Therefore, I'm expecting God to honor His promise. I believe His promise, so I'm expecting it. That's how hope or expectation works. And Luke 6:34, Jesus says, if you only lend to those from whom you expect a return. What He's talking about is lending to those that can't pay you back, to making a gift. But if you only lend to those that you expect to return, that's the word expect. Expecting. 1 Peter 1:13 talks about, let me read that to you. That's a really important one, similar to what we've got. 1 Peter 1:13, he says, therefore, gird your mind, prepare your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Attach or fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. When he says fix your hope, he means to attach it. Attach your hope. Do you know how to do that in your soul? Did you know you have the ability to expect? You have the ability to believe. You can believe anything. You can believe anything. Did you know that the doctor told me that I'm going to grow another 6 inches in just a few years? You believe that? You can believe that if you want to. Do what now? Keep eating. Keep eating. No, I'm talking about, you're talking about this way. Yeah. Yeah. Now that's entirely possible. Absolutely. Thank you, sir. Now, see, you can believe anything. It doesn't have to be true. And you believing it doesn't make it true. What's true is what's true. God is the arbiter of what's true. He knows what's true. Our goal is to take what our perception of what's true and align it with His. then we're right on line with what's true. But what you believe is, what you attach your faith to is what you believe. How do you attach? You simply attach your faith. All right. Hebrews chapter 4. Unless you think I'm making this up. Verse 1 and 2. Hebrews 4, 1 and 2. Therefore let us fear, since the promise of entering His rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you found to be short have fallen short of it. For we also have had the gospel preached to us, just as they did Exodus generation. But the message they heard was of no value to them, because those who heard it did not combine it or attach it with faith. They didn't hear the message and take their faith and attach it. That's how it works. That's a choice. You say, well, I got no basis to do that. I got no reason to believe it. Why should I believe that? I need evidence to believe it, Will. So be it. Go for it. See where that gets you. How's that working for you? You don't need evidence. What you need is to hear with your spirit. If you hear with your spirit, you'll know it. When you hear the truth, you'll know it. If you ever stop to hear and listen with your spirit, wanting to, if you want the truth, God will give it to you and you will hear it. And you will know it. And when you attach your faith to it, it will explode inside of you. It will change you inside. And when that happens, whatever the promise is, you believe, you will begin to expect that to happen. That's what hope is that expecting. It's really important. You got to have that going on in your Christian life to make things go well. If your hopes are in the wrong things, you're not going to go well. Now, let's move on to, hope or expectation is about the future. It comes from our beliefs. These are some passages you should read. Our hope is our personal attachment to a positive future, what we hope for ourselves, and on you can read this. This will be another study we'll do. But secondly, the object of hope or expectations determines its validity. See, it's not about can I believe, can I expect. It's about what do I believe. Everybody believes something. Everybody believes something. And what often the Bible calls a lack of faith is actually a faith in something incorrect or inappropriate. You don't trust God means you trust something else. Because you're going to trust. Bob Dylan says, you're going to serve somebody. You're going to believe something. Now in Job, he talks about false hope or what we call unrealistic expectations. This is what marriage counseling is about helping people unload their unrealistic expectations. Take those things off, erase them from their soul, and replace them with something realistic, something real. Job 8 talks about the hope of the godless will perish. Those whose expectations are not connected to God will perish. Don't make gold your hope or put confidence in wealth, he says in Job 31:24. Back to Job 8:14, those who forget God, their hope is in the strength, is like the strength of a spider's web. In Jeremiah 17:5, it says, thus saith the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man, and makes flesh his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. False hope is the expectation that man or the things of this life can save or give happiness. False hope is the belief that your good works will count with God when you get in front of Him in the eternal judgment. See, at the great white throne, there's the book of life is opened, then it says the book of works is opened. And you're going to be able to point to all of the good things you did, how you fed the neighbor's dog, and you petted all the animals. You know, you were good to the earth. I believe we should take care of the earth. And that's just common sense. Shouldn't dump into our rivers. That's common sense. But we don't need to make it into a religion. But your good works, if your hope is in your good works, you're going to be disappointed. False hope comes from believing the world's lie of life without God. False hope pursues the things of this life for happiness. It's false hope. It's false hope. You're going to pursue something that even if you get it or don't get it, it's not going to satisfy anyway. It's false hope. Look, you're chasing your tail. And it's a stinky one too. You need to get off of that and get on to God. False hope will always bring utter disappointment. Utter disappointment. Godly hope, in contrast, is to place your faith or your hope in God, in the things of eternity. In Luke 12:33, Jesus was telling the rich young ruler, sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourself that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will not be exhausted, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. In Colossians chapter 1, something really important to notice, if you'll go back to Colossians chapter 1 for a second, try to wake you all up. Everybody's going to sleep. Listen, I hope you have some good dreams. Good dreams. He says in verse 5, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Is that what your Bible says? Listen, this is what it should say. Because of the hope that is being laid up for you in heaven. In other words, this is an ongoing process related to your eternal rewards for the Christian life you're living. This is not just the salvation package, it's the growth package, the maturity package that you're building as you live as a Christian warrior. Psalm 31:24, those who trust in the Lord will strengthen their hearts. Hope in the Lord quiets the disturbed soul. Hope in the Lord receives answer to prayer. I promise you, if you're sitting there with a disturbed soul, anxious, if you will turn your mind and begin to visualize the promises of God and the things that He's promised to give you and see yourself in that and tell yourself it's true, it will begin to quiet your soul. It is important to be realistic about what God is promising. He does not promise to protect us from the evil things in this life. You can pray for that, but it's not. He doesn't promise to keep you from failure or struggle. It's not going to happen. You're going to face the difficulties. He promises the strength to overcome the evil in the world. He's not going to keep you from it. He's going to give you the strength to overcome it, which is better. He does not promise relationships without disappointment. He promises to strengthen our capacity to love without conditions, enable us to forgive. Forgiveness is how relationships work. It's how they keep working. Listen, we go into relationships thinking that it's our love for them and their love for us and their virtue. Listen, that their virtue, the virtue of the one we love, is what's going to keep our love going. And that's one of your first big disappointments in life, is when you realize that the virtue that you saw in the one of your beloved doesn't go to the bone. It only goes as deep as they've developed maturity. Enough pressure and you're going to see some of that virtue, some of that shine rub off. And you're going to be disillusioned. And that's when you're going to start to realize how important the grace of God is. Because the other, you know what your partner's doing? They're saying the same thing in you. promises to strengthen our capacity to love without conditions and to forgive. Hope in the Lord never ends in disappointment. In Romans 5:5, and hope does not disappoint because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. I would encourage you, as we close, to ask yourself a question. Here's your question for the day. What is it that, if you closed your eyes, in fact, if you would, bow your heads and close your eyes for a second, if everybody would do that. What is it that you picture in your future that gives you that wonderful feeling of happiness? Everybody's got this wonderful feeling of happiness that we all want. What is it you picture? Is it a relationship? Is it a situation? Is it simply your health? I mean, is it your children or your grandchildren? What is it that you're attached to, that you're visualizing and thinking and believing, if this could only happen, then I would be happy. I would be content. And I want you to realize that whatever that is, it's a lie. If it's not God in the Christian life, in the capacity to live freely without worldly attachments, then it's false. False hope. If you're here this morning again, if you've never trusted in Christ, and you didn't really understand what you were supposed to believe, then understand this, that the gospel, the message of salvation is simply this. Christ paid for your sins, was buried and raised from the dead. He defeated everything. He took away everything that would keep you from being with God forever. But only he can do that. And the only way anyone ever is accepted by God is if they go through Christ and the work of Christ. If you bring your own works, your own goodness, your own good deeds, and think that you've done more good than bad and you're going to offer that to God, he's just going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. And that's going to be the saddest and most horrible day of your life. Because your life's not going to be over, it's going to go on and on and on in a terrible place. I didn't make that up. I didn't make it up to get your money. It's what the Bible teaches. Father, we're so grateful for your Son, Jesus Christ, who rescued us out of this terrible dilemma of being lost in Adam and being under the condemnation of the justice of God. And I thank you, Father, for the freedom that we have to believe in Christ and to be saved and to be eternally secure. Pray this morning that we'll take what is given in the basket, that those who are visiting will understand this is for home folks. We're not looking for anybody's money. Everything we give is for free. It's courtesy of Jesus Christ. But take what we give and multiply it many times for the kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.